Hi, good evening. Welcome to Test Talk. TEST is not an exam, as I said. It's a tertiary education skills training, and it is what happens to your kids after secondary school. Tonight we talk about the education city, and to help us along and to explain what it is and what the concept is about, I have as my guest Mr. Peter Kanhai, Ms. Khadija Amin, and Dr. Asad Mohammed, who is the chairman of a group involved with the education city. What do you mean by that, though, Dr. Mohammed? What is an education city?
Well, the education city is the way we have called it in Trinidad, but it's a specific term for a wider group of type of areas called knowledge cities, education cities, university towns, and it's really a space in which you try to make use of the training and educational facilities there to foster and support economic development activities.
So obviously, if you're talking about university cities and things, this is a concept that goes back to the 12th or 13th centuries.
Yes, it does. Academic activities, training has always had relations to business and trade. Mm-hmm. And some of the more modern ideas is to link this to more knowledge-based economic activities.
But clearly, the whole society is evolving towards knowledge workers. All of us who are here are knowledge workers.
Well, not the whole society. All the lead economies in the world are no longer based on manufacturing. They're based on knowledge-based and creative industries.
Okay, Mr. Amin, you have anything to add to that?
Well, in fact, Tony, while I was a chairman of Tunapunapiako Corporation, I became a member of the committee and I continue to represent the interests of local government on the St. Augustine Education City Committee.
So we're talking here right now as a pilot project, the St. Augustine Education City?
Indeed. Yeah. The St. Augustine, the committee is a cabinet-appointed committee comprising of persons from various organizations and various backgrounds, including the University of the West Indies, business, local government, planning, the private tertiary level institutions. And the committee is tasked to make recommendations back to cabinet with regards to forming this education city. And we have been working for quite some time, so we would have engaged several agencies who are service providers within the specified area. And the area really is St. Augustine from the Orange Grove Road in Takarikwa, coming westward to the Mount Hope, which includes Mount Hope Medical Sciences Complex, and south of the highway, going a little way south of the highway and coming north until the foothills of the Northern Range.
That's
so
interesting.
The El Dorado Nursing School, for example,
is part of the education city. So Peter, you're not a nurse. I know, just joke. What is your role in this?
My role is that I represent the business community in the area that is conceived as the education city. And the purpose of the education city is really for economic development along knowledge-based activities. And there are a number of tertiary education institutions, private and public, in that area concentrated. Mm-hmm. And therefore, from a business standpoint, there are lots of opportunities for entrepreneurs to develop small, medium-sized business in particular. And therefore, the business community and the chamber that I represent, the Tunapuna Chamber and so on, we are on this committee as part of this project to make sure that there is benefit to the community, both the business community and the wider community in the area, and of course, to the national community.
Dr. Mohammed, why the choice of St. Augustine and that area? I don't understand.
Well, I thought that would be obvious because they have the largest concentration of tertiary education institutions in the country. Not just UWI, but UWI is a major one. Mm-hmm. As Peter said, there's a range of private sector. There's SAMS, there's SPSC, there is the Hugh Wooding, there is Arthur Lockjack, There is the Cipriani Labor College. There is University of Trinidad and Tobago in Valsine, the Teachers Training College. There are a whole proliferation of secondary schools and the range of economic activities. There are also specific training activities. Metal Industries, Institute of Technology is also there. So we have perhaps the largest concentration of existing training activities taking place in St. Augustine.
But it seems to me though that education is a little bit broader than schooling. And while you're talking about schools and whatever level, I'm not hearing how the education, I don't understand how the education part fits in. Do you want to talk to me about that?
Well, Peter made the critical link between education and training and economic activity. Mm-hmm. So we have been working at three different levels that education supports economic activity and leads to it. We're doing a pretty good job in Trinidad on the first level, which is how you supply trained and educated people to the workforce to support economic activity. We're doing a pretty good job on that. The next level is where you actually sell training and research services abroad. It's an export activity. Mm-hmm. They come here or they export the activities. Britain has done a lot of that. You know, we're doing external degrees. That's a form of export. And that is what the El Dorado Nursing and Allied Health Facility is about. When we were conceptualizing that, we said first we have a shortfall of nurses in the Trinidad and allied health training. But once we serve that immediate need, the idea is to provide the institution will provide those services to the wider Caribbean area. So there's another level where you're actually selling your education services. And the third one is really the crux of where we want to arrive at, which is the quality of the research you have going on, the skilled people. You start to get business startups, small, medium-sized industries Peter were talking about. And I'll give you a couple of illustrations of that. The BlackBerry used to be the most popular smartphone. Mm-hmm. Well, I went to University of Waterloo as undergrad, and there was a research park right next to the university, and the professors were doing research in there. The students were moving back and forth, and they were creating products for sale, making use of the School of Math and Computer Science at Waterloo, Cambridge. So these universities, because of the type of work they're doing, Stanford University, they are spawning economic activities and business startups on their boundaries. And pretty soon you will see knowledge parks, research parks, and so on and around these universities. And that's where a hotbed of exchange between education, research, and economic activity takes place. So that's the future where we go it there.
Okay, but we have a long way away from that, I would think. I don't know how you feel about it.
Well, the foundation is there. There are numerous existing agencies, organizations, secondary schools, tertiary level institutions. The basic road network exists. Of course, there's need for improvement. There's need for changes. There's the need to improve the transportation. Culturally, how we treat with a number of things, including transportation, security, garbage collection, to recycle. And all of those things, of course, would add to and improve on the services within the area. We have been able to work with PTSC with regards to doing an overall plan, but providing a service that will specifically connect the tertiary level institutions. For example, there may be the need for a nursing student at El Dorado to go to the Mount Hope Medical Sciences Complex. And of course, they would have to take the regular transportation that is available. But the special service would connect all of those institutions. And the idea, of course, is to expand on it. So when you talk about security, for instance, having tying in with transportation, having pedestrian areas where pedestrians have the right of way, bicycle lanes, having park and ride services. Of course, you must have good transportation for people to park their vehicle. And how that ties in with having well-lit, well-constructed sidewalks for those pedestrians to use, and having those routes connect the institutions, connect the services that give support to the institutions, and of course those routes must be secure. So they must not only be well lit and well constructed, but they must be secure, whether it is by camera security monitoring or police patrols. And we have been working with the UE's security department, as well as the National Police, with regards to laying the groundwork, laying the foundation, and of course, how we go forward, expanding on it and making those recommendations back to government.
Okay, that is really good to have.
Make a link to what Samin was just saying. In the education cities that are working and successful, that we have examined around the world, there is always a quality of living and quality of environment that's part of it. In other words, people go to live or work or do business startups or go to school in areas in which these types of amenities are improved. Security, transportation, housing, those types of services. So every successful education or knowledge city we've seen, those physical, spatial, infrastructural aspects are important parts of it. Quality of life aspects. So those support the economic activities that you're trying to foster.
Well, I was at Boston. Boston University, and had access to Harvard, MIT, and about 17 universities within that conurbation, and within that area. So I understand some of it, and I'll come back to looking at some comparisons. But let me ask Peter. Peter, much of the businesses in Trinidad are commission agency businesses. People buy cheap and sell dear locally. I don't see how our local businessmen could get involved in something like that in any meaningful way.
Well, in this particular geographical space that you're talking about, there are a lot of built-up businesses, a lot of, as you say, retail business, right? But we do have three industrial parks in the area as well. And the catchment of the population, that is the student population, is quite a large number of persons and potential customers to various businesses. So that part of what the education city is going to do is to bring some structure into the new startups, businesses, and so on, because we're looking at as a knowledge park in one zone, where we're looking at integrating the existing businesses into the whole atmosphere of our education city. We have been discussing the question of cloud cover connectivity and that kind of thing. And one of the things over the years that has developed as a business model has been the real estate development in and around the institutions, particularly of the University of the West Indies. Unfortunately, it has been done very haphazard. And so part of the work that this committee have is to see how we can bring some regularization and structure into the development of student housing, for example, and to interconnect all of the institutions, both the university, the main university, UE, and all of the private institutions. As Khadija said, we've been in consultation with the PTSC, and out of that has come what we call the hopper bus, which is a service that goes around that zone. There is also the bus service that comes from San Fernando that brings students into UE, that comes from San Grande into UE, and one from Digger Martin into UE. So it's quite a whole network of initiatives that is taking place simultaneously.
And Tony, may I add, one of the concerns that business people, as well as people who provide housing for students, one of the challenges that they have is with regards to the regulations for planning in the country. And of course, town and country planning has a role. The local government ministry has a role. And there are a number of areas where businessmen who, although they are willing to finance a building, they were limited by the law with regards to how high they can go and how much they can maximize that space for economic activities. Even where you have students or in and around UE, housing has been a challenge. Secure housing, safe housing, has been a challenge.
Has
and
been
even
a very big challenge.
Even where you have persons who are willing to invest in a building to provide safe buildings for students to use as housing, they may not be permitted to really maximize on the space because of the laws. And Town and Country has been working with us, the Director of Planning is in fact on the committee, the acting director, so that they can take what we discuss at our committee level and the activities within the specified area and let that feed into what they are doing in terms of changing the regulations for planning.
We have already done a joint activity between MTES and our committee and the Ministry of Planning. We produce a joint, of course the Ministry of Planning remains the planning authority. Mm-hmm. We produce a new development plan for the area. And the area sets out in the land use strategies for the area some of the proposals that we have for like the Knowledge Park, for better housing, for infrastructure services, but it also provides development incentives, mm-hmm. higher densities, so we could provide the right type of housing. People have constraints
right.
in housing zones and identifying areas where we'll allow a higher density of business development. So there are also a range of built and non-built incentives that are being prepared to encourage investment in the area.
Well, yeah, but when you look at it, that area now is basically a dormitory city.
Yeah.
People live there but work in town. To keep people there, you need to have a mix of not just academics and rich people, but you need middle class people and you need people, tradespeople who will fix the cars, and you need banks and all of that. To what extent is that happening, that well, mix?
Tonopuna and its environs is one of the most thriving business hubs in the country. Khadija will tell you that the Tonopuna Piarco Regional Corporation is the largest, and both in terms of physical size and in terms of population.
Mm.
The chamber, for example, have made calls over the years for upgrading the space to borough status. We have all of the financial institutions, be it banks or insurance companies and so on. We have all of the various services, accounting, medical. As a matter of fact, apart from this area being the most intense in educational facilities, it is also the most intense in terms of medical institution, private medical institutions, private hospitals, and so on.
Private and public.
So it's built up.
Okay, let me just pause it there. We're just going for a break now. When we come back, I want to develop that point, and I want to be particularly clear on the role of the university. Why give a leadership role to the university and the rest of this? So, folks, let us take a break now. We'll come back with Test Talk in a short while. And in the meantime, remember, this is the future of your kids who are now in secondary school. When they leave it, what happens next? Thank you. Welcome back to Test Talk, Tertiary Education Skills Training. And we're talking about the Education City, which is a concept right now rather than an actuality in the strictest sense of the word, located in the St. Augustine and environs area, Tonopuna. And Peter had tried to explain to me that the business people here are not only into what we call commission agency business, but they actually are pioneers. They are developing new products and new ways of doing things. Yep. Peter, you want to complete that?
Yes, well, as I said, we have, in that geographical space, we have three business parks.
Mm.
Right? But one of the things that the creation of the Education City will bring about is the Knowledge Park, where we will encourage innovation and incubator business startups and that kind of thing. As I said, we have the largest concentration of population in one regional corporation space. We have the medical fraternity. We have the largest concentration of private medical institutions. So that while you might be right that people live there and work in Port of Spain and elsewhere, there are also thousands of people who work within that area. Mm-hmm. Whether they live in the area or not, they work in the area. So from a business point of view, the catchment of customer base is there night and day.
Okay. But Dr. Mohamed, I hate to say it like this, but I think I regard it as important. Here we're talking about business and profitability, and what's the university doing in this?
Well, I could explain what the university is doing in it.
Yeah.
In the context of what the government should be doing for it.
Okay.
We've been talking about diversifying the economy for a long time.
Right.
And still the economy is largely dependent first on the petroleum sector and then the state sector.
Yeah.
If you look at the countries that have managed to diversify the economies and become self-sufficient, the Taiwans, the Hong Kongs, the Singapores, and so on, the state has a role.
Yeah.
And if you look at their training and research expenditure budgets, you will see that they're very large. So what the state's role is here is that they are trying to provide a critical mass of support for research funding and for training, and to try and make the linkages to support business. Yes, we've had a tradition of mercantile traders,
but
as the old colonial structure, how do we break out of that? We break out of that by trying to provide the wherewithal to create participation in the new knowledge economy.
Mm-hmm.
We don't do that at our own peril. Because if you look at the statistics internationally, you will see those are the driving industries of growth everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have a choice. Tony, we have to be involved in this. And it's tied into the economic strategy of the government, the growth strategies, the pillars of development. Knowledge, creative, and cultural industries are very high on that. So we may not quite have the skills like India or Bangalore to do software development, but a critical part of the new knowledge industry is what they call creative and cultural industries. And surely, Trinidad and Tobago has a long history and a lot of capacity in doing that. How we link natural talent and creativity to economic activity and industry in the knowledge-based area is what we're trying to do. The committee can't do that. The committee can provide research funding, support for research funding, work with the institutions, because we have to work with a range of institutions to provide incentives, work with the institutions to provide incubation for it. So yes, the universities have a role to play. All the universities, UTT, COSTAT, the University of the Southern Caribbean, which is also in the education city, we didn't mention that, and the UWI. So yes, I'm the representative of UWI on the committee. But we don't see this as a UWI thing. We see this as an education sector activity. And yes, the education sector has been providing trained people. They need to step up to the plate and provide linkages with economic activity. UTT is now calls itself the Innovation University, and they see that as their mandate. So I'm not wearing a UWI hat to take, take the blues, to take the blues for that there.
Well, as I said, as I'm going to ask Khadija now, what is the role of local government in this? Are you representing the government or local government?
Well, in fact, Tony, many of the roads within the education city area are local roads.
Okay.
Many of the activities are related to the development of the infrastructure that falls under local government. Also, there are several communities that are stakeholders and we engage them regularly in the Education City Committee. From local government, you also get the issues with regards to how we treat with our garbage or waste disposal, basic services that are offered at from the local government, but also the impact it has on people and on communities. And it is not only about creating a good space for students and business and the economy, but also giving considerations to those citizens who live within that area and who would be a part of any activities that we have. If, for instance, the Education City Committee agrees that within this area we will have a very green approach to the collection of garbage and separation at curb, it does not only impact students or businesses, it impacts on citizens. And there are a number of local government issues and community issues within the Education City. And it also includes how the various agencies relate to these communities. TNTEC, for instance, the Ministry of National Security and the policing units, and so on.
Well, yeah.
I want to make a little linkage between what she's talking about. The government recently passed the Planning and Facilitation and Development Act. And this new act, the concept of subsidiarity, which means that decisions take place at the lowest possible level, is built into that. So the ability to make plans is not now a central government function, it is now a municipal function.
Okay.
So the new plan, the physical and the spatial plan we've been working with Town and Country Planning Division on, will have to be implemented and championed by the municipal authority, in this case, the Tunapuna Piarco Regional Corporation. So there must be a linkage between anything we're trying to do in the space that will be managed by the Education City, and it falls within the Tunapuna Piarco Corporation. So like I'd mentioned before, it's not just the activity, the quality of life in the area contributes towards the nature of investment and the viability and the success of the economic activities. So we see an integral link between the work that we are trying to do and the relevant regional corporation. We have proposed to Cabinet that the Education City has a development authority status.
Yeah.
That is an authority that proposes and develops a concept, but it is not going to become a regulatory or planning authority.
Right.
That will remain the function of the municipal planning authority, which is the Tunapuna Piarco Regional Corporation. So that's a linkage.
No, I'd like to see that. So where does business fit into that model?
Well, let me just go back a little bit to something that Dr. Mohammed said when a little earlier when he spoke about the development of the cultural and creative industries. And I can tell you that the chamber in the area, the Tunapuna Chamber, and during my 5 years as its president, we always made recommendations to the powers that be for more focus to be put on the development of that industry, the creative and cultural industry. And to bring a link to show how the development of that industry and education takes place. We have something that is taking place, have been taking place for about a decade or so in that area. We have something called the Birdsong Academy that have been carrying on classes and teaching young people music, both theory and practical, and turning out some first-class musicians. And that is an industry that must be focused on. I saw recently in online, there was a publication of a list of the richest people in the United Kingdom. And the man that was at the top of that list with a value of some 13.17 billion pounds is in the entertainment industry, right? The Queen was way down the line, right? So that all of that is taking place in that area. And so there's the formal education structure and there's the informal education structure, such as the Birdsong Academy or the Exo Cubs school that's taking place in the Panhard and that kind of thing. And this is what the Education City is trying to bring some structure into. And in all of that, there are business opportunities.
And in addition to which, within the past 5 years, you would have seen a lot more decentralization take place. The government's approach to bringing services closer to communities especially in the rural areas, has also had an impact on a built-up area like Tunapuna. Within the education city, you can find every government agency's services available at a place within this area. It includes many of our vocation skills training that also fall under the Ministry of Education, a tertiary education and skills training. And that provides ready opportunities for businesses in terms of recruitment, but it also allows trained people to access education and later on access business opportunities as well as jobs.
That's interesting. But Dr. Bowman, what is the role of the ministry itself of tertiary education and skills training? Is there a specific role? What does it do with this?
Well, the ministry's primary responsibility is in the area of the provision of tertiary education and skills training. And the education city is therefore to foster training and education, but to use it to leverage it.
Yeah.
So yes, we are located in the Ministry of Tertiary Education and Skills Training, but as you mentioned, we have been making direct linkages with the Ministry of Planning and Sustainable Development.
So the role is more facilitative rather than implementation.
It is umbrella. Because in fact what will happen is that the implementation takes place via a range of different other agencies. So we've been in touch, we've been in dialogue with InvestTT and ETEC. Because the knowledge park that we're talking about putting together, we worked out the concept and the framework of a knowledge park. We will not implement the knowledge park itself. That will be an ETEC part.
Yes.
And the leveraging of the investment incentives mm-hmm. and the marketing of the opportunities will be done by InvestTT. Okay. So I just want to make one other linkage. As you know, there is a growth pool strategy of the Ministry of Planning and Sustainable Development. There are a few with very specific areas. This is not one of the five priority areas. There are five priority areas. But in the planning function, every part of Trinidad must have a development strategy.
Okay.
We could call it a growth pool, we call it development strategy. The development strategy for this particular part of Trinidad is education-based.
Mm-hmm.
This is the driving economic force as a catalyst for economic development in this spatial area. In the same Tunapuna Piarco Regional Corporation, the airport zone will be around the airport activities.
Yeah, okay.
But in fact, UWI has a campus close to the airport, and that provides an opportunity.
What campus is this?
But they have a space.
Okay.
Not a campus as yet.
Okay.
And that's an opportunity to provide a linkage between airport activities and education activities, because it happens all around the world, conferencing and so on. But if I'll tell you some of the activities that are already going on.
Okay, that'll be important.
Right. Peter said we have a large concentration of medical facilities.
Right.
And therefore, one of the areas identified is obviously medical-based.
Now, you talked about research. Are we doing any research in that area yet or not?
Well, there's a tremendous amount of research. I think that the quality of the research and the relevance of the research as goes on is not very well known. There's a program that is funded by the government and was administered by UWI for a while and is now being administered by the ministry directly, is the RDI, the Research and Development Impact Fund.
Okay.
And that particular research is geared specifically towards economic and developmental impact. So for example, I'm doing a project under that in East Port of Spain.
Okay.
And the project is geared about leveraging built and cultural heritage for economic development. So right now we have a project that's funded under that on looking at how we leverage our cocoa production for economic activity coming out of the cocoa industry. So
but East Port of Spain?
Well, no. There's a different project. Give an example of the way it works, right?
There for a minute.
No, just give an example.
I used to go to school there. I can't remember.
How the RDI fund works. So what the government of Trinidad and Tobago has been doing is to develop a fund which is now under the responsibility of the National Commission for Education, which is to provide resources to support relevant research that will support economic activity. And Peter and I had the opportunity to go to Singapore, where we've seen the way in which the government gets involved through funding research linked to its economic development strategy and economic development board. So the research is not only blue sky research. You need some of that.
Yeah.
It is focused developmental research. And there's a very specific attempt to link it to business startups and economic activities.
Incubation, right?
So a couple of days ago, there was a sod turning for an arm of a new wing to the Arthur Lockjack School of Business. And at that point, the principal of UWI talked about linking it to not just School of Business, but School of Management. And we would like to make additional link, and that is to link that to a business park and incubation activities. So we're only teaching about research. We're actually going to get them out there in the real world doing business startups and incubation activities, linking them to innovation.
If you don't mind, I think you need to explain what you mean by incubation activities.
Okay.
It'll be important.
Sorry, yeah. Incubation activity is you may be a brilliant IT specialist, or you may develop a beautiful process for improving cocoa and making a product, but you're not a business person.
All
right. You need some help. You need to take your scientific research and your beautiful worked out idea, and you need to take it through the steps of how you turn it into a product, how you market the product, how you get it financed. And many places we have what a support for that is how you incubate this little nascent idea, this little baby, or the chick, the egg, and turn the egg into a full-blown fowl or a business. That is what you incubate the activity.
Okay.
Kariri has some of it going on right now. Mm-hmm. So we've already started some discussions with Kariri as how we could link up. We're not trying to create anything new, you know. The committee is trying to work with various types of existing government services and put them together to create this ferment that will allow us to translate it into economic activity.
Kharija, as a government representative, I was not living in Trinidad for a long while, came back in, and we keep hearing about growth pools and pillars and things. I get totally confused with that. What is that about?
Well, Dr. Asad Mohammed sat as the chairman of the National Planning Task Force for some time, and really, in simple language, the five growth poles identified are five areas where there's going to be a concentration of development. That includes planning and development. And the education city is not one of those areas. But of course, it is an area where you're going to have development that is knowledge driven.
Yeah.
So of course, it is one of those secondary areas as opposed to the five areas that are the key areas identified as the development, those key points.
So where do the pillars come in this thing? People keep talking about pillars of development, growth pools and things. I get totally confused.
Well, if I as a representative of the government, as you called me, the government's manifesto has become policy, government policy, and there are seven pillars identified in the manifesto. And within the education city, five of those pillars apply. And of course, they speak about several things, including technology-driven education and development. We talk about sustainable economic development and so on. And in almost every project that is done by every minister and every government, within the government, there are certain pillars that apply. And that is to ensure that there is coordination and harmonization amongst all the areas of development, and that we stick to those seven basic pillars that really hold up everything.
The pillars have not been left standing alone.
Okay.
Various other policy documents have been developed upon the pillars. So the manifesto may have been the policy framework to guide it. There's a medium-term macroeconomic framework, policy framework that was developed. There is a national sustainable development strategy. There's a national spatial development strategy. So these three documents, an economic, an environmental, and a spatial, have filled out various aspects of these pillars of development. So it is the core principles on which these various types of different development strategies are based on. And therefore, there is some harmonization between the objectives of the spatial development plan and the economic development plan. So is it common threads and objectives, development objectives, that run through all the secondary level policy development documents.
Okay. But Peter, as a businessman, how does that relate to you? I mean, these are government policy and government pillars and government things.
Well, one of the things that you hear from business people, not just those of us in the Tonopona and Education City area, but from business people all over the place. As a matter of fact, last week the Manufacturers Association had a series of discussions. And one of the things that you hear is the question of challenges with the labor force and workforce.
Okay.
Not that there aren't people to work, but they aren't properly skilled to meet the requirements of the industries and so on. So that there is a need to direct the type of graduates that are coming out of the institutions to meet the demands of the existing industries and the developing industries. That is part of what the Education City work is doing. Because business people and entrepreneurs, they look at everything and see the opportunities that there are in it. So when governments create their pillars, as you call them, and well, in layman terms, their focal points of development, the business community and the entrepreneurial mind will look at that to see where there is an opportunity to start up a business. Mm-hmm. Dr. Mohammed referred to Singapore earlier on, and how they encourage their young people and their graduates and so on through the incubator system. Now, we have had in this country for decades institutions of state that provide funding for startup business and incubator business, NETCO, Business Development Corporation, and so on. But they have never really provided that kind of hold your hand assistance to make sure that your idea blossoms into a successful business. And that is where we are trying to take the incubator system and knowledge park system.
You're nodding, Khadija. What part of that do you consider the more important?
Well, Tony, because I am a person who has been very involved in communities, for me, my involvement always, for me, must have a link back to the average citizen, the normal man on the street, the young person who is coming into the university or any tertiary level institution to do studies in an area simply because they like it. And it's important for an entire structure to be built that will give support that would bring results years from now. And while the interest of the businessman, of course, would be looking at opportunities, in 4 years from now, a new student starting in a tertiary level institution will be looking for opportunities as well. But whereas the businessman would have the experience, it is important for the support to be given to that young student who is coming out brilliant or not so brilliant, but having been exposed to a course of study, having access to research and information, and the facilities, all the education facilities that would have provided that, but ensuring that it goes further. So that incubation process is very important, not to become something to be dependent upon, but of course to give you that support to allow you to grow. And this in turn will attract investors to our country and improve the economy, not only of that education city, the local economy, but the economy of Trinidad and Tobago. And it also would be a driver in terms of tourism, health tourism, people coming to Trinidad and Tobago for healthcare, education tourism, in that we will have students abroad who are writing exams in Trinidad, or students coming to Trinidad to study education tourism, as well as our traditional sun, sea, and sand.
Thank you very much. We We're going to take a short break now. We're on Test Talk, tertiary education, skills training, and looking at life beyond CXE or CSEC or whatever they call it. Thank you all very much. We'll rejoin you later, or you'll rejoin us later in just a few minutes. Thank you all. Hi, welcome back to Test Talk, Tertiary Education Skills Training. We've been talking about the education city that is being developed in St. Augustine, Tanapuna, and its environments, mainly because of the number of teaching and training institutions, medical schools, and all the other paraphernalia, all the other institutions that are there, including business opportunities, including a large number of people. What we want to talk about now and to take the discussion is we were talking before with Minister Fazal Karim and some of the other people from the tertiary education and skills training area about the concept of the entrepreneurial university, where people leave not looking for a job in the public service or waiting to find something to do, but where they develop their own businesses even before they leave the training institution. How did the two concepts fit together, Dr. Mohamed?
If I summarize that, we have to transform the university systems in our country if we're going to have entrepreneurial universities.
Okay.
Because part of the reasons why it is because these universities were set up to train people for certain the nature of enterprise that existed at that time. Mm-hmm. They weren't really set up to train us to be independent entrepreneurial societies. I mean, if you look at the universities themselves, there is a fight going on in most of these universities that people who teach in universities should be promoted and recognized for creating economic activity and patrons. Their normal reference is that you produce high-quality referee journal papers. Yeah. Now, that's important,
yeah. But
there's been a real struggle to recognize that people of high academic quality could also be producing inputs into business development activities. How do we make training and research relevant to economic development, mm-hmm. right? And that is a real transformation yeah. is needed in the sector. So you have a national university, which is not a set up in the old colonial structure, UTT, which is much more nimble on its feet,
yeah.
right? UWI is like a big ocean liner. You can't just turn it around like that. It takes some time, right? You know, it's a big trajectory. UDT is small and nimble. COSTAT is even small and more nimble. So each of the universities have a different role to play. And the Ministry of Tertiary Education and National Commission for Education must do that. There's a role for what UE does, but there's also a role for what UDT and what COSTAT does. And one of the criticisms we've had, obviously, I'm in the institution, is we could produce people to do agricultural research, and we could produce people to do extension. But we don't seem to be able to produce farmers yeah. or agribusiness.
Yeah.
We change one of the courses to agribusiness. Mm. But I don't know how many agribusiness people we're turning out.
Yeah.
So yes, we could start with the concepts and the names, but ultimately it is the teaching who we recruit and what the incentives you provide for them.
Right.
And that is what our entrepreneurial university is about. It is about the quality of the courses, the incentive system, and how to link what we teach with what is required out there, but not what is only out there right now, what produces for the next wave of economic activity that will come out. Mm-hmm. So yes, there's a transformation of the tertiary education system and the university system that is required. And I think that the National Commission has already started that work. But again, this is not something that will happen overnight.
Yeah. But our business, is our business community or business organizations ready for something like this, Peter?
Let me answer that question this way. Dr. Mohamed earlier mentioned that the University of the West West Indies have a large space in the vicinity of the airport,
yeah.
which really is a huge acreage of land, and it's prime agricultural land.
Okay.
We at the business community have been recommending that perhaps there needs to be a tripartite link where that land is made available to our farmers
mm-hmm.
with support from the university that do the necessary studies and research as to what's the best crops and so on.
Mm.
And alongside that, with the government and the private sector developing what we call an agro-industrial park, where industries, processing plants and so on are put in. So the farmers, university does the research, the farmers plant and grow the crops, and the business community purchase the crops, do the processing and that kind of thing. So we've been thinking about that for quite some time.
Okay, but where it gone?
Well, the discussions have been moving along,
okay.
but as Dr. Mohammed just said, the University of the West Indies is such a large liner that it takes a little while to turn it.
The government is almost as big a liner.
Well, the good thing is that the government's policies would sort of have to allow the suggestions and discussions of the business community to fit into a national plan, a development plan, or even a regional plan. We have had discussions with the business community in Tunapuna, the chamber, and we have had a number of other stakeholder meetings with, for instance, the regulatory agencies, with the those persons who provide housing around the university area, within a St. Augustine Education City area, the landlords and the developers.
Business community.
We have had, of course, the business community, but we have also had with communities. We have had with the schools, the tertiary and secondary schools. In fact, up to this week, we visited all the secondary school, the primary schools, in the Education City area, and redistributed a package for them for SEA. And that is really so that they would be aware that their school sits within the Education City of Trinidad and Tobago. And these stakeholder conversations have allowed us to not only share information, but engage people to participate in the activities that will create this Education City.
Probably just one last question. We don't have that much time, but still, where do we go from here? What is the next step in this thing?
The next step, there are a few steps. One is that knowledge park that Peter's been talking about is a very critical element because it's actually creating the physical space in partnership with the universities and the private sector, where you will have the transfer and the cross-fertilization between research, training, and business activity. And in there, applied research can take place around specific areas that are geared towards economic activity. So that's one very critical thing. The next critical thing is we need incentives for business startups.
Mm-hmm.
We've already pinned down some of those incentives with the Ministry of Planning. Physical incentives to build, to intensify. We need to work out the financial incentives.
Dr. Mohammed, thank you. I didn't want to stop here, but we have to. And I hope we could all come back, maybe in a few months, and take it from next. In the meantime, I would like, of course, San Fernando to be considered as the next pilot project.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is UE in South now.
Yeah,
well,
that's what I'm saying. But there's much more.
I expect you'll have a lot of growth around that.
There's a lot more to come with that. But thank you all for looking at tonight's show, Test Talk. And we'll be back next Friday with another one in the series. Thanks a lot.